On this episode of It's a Miracle, a young wife and mother fights the debilitating effects of multiple sclerosis.
She would lose the ability to stand or walk. It's painful to watch your mate progressively getting worse, and there's nothing you can do about it. You don't know what to do about it.
And when modern medicine fails to help her, her only hope is a miracle. Plus, it's a mad dash through rush hour traffic to reach a hospital as a young woman suffers intense labor contractions.
They were 45 seconds long, with only a few seconds in between. And I knew that was hard labor. And that's when I started to really get scared.
But their most terrifying moment lay ahead. These stories and more on this edition of It's a Miracle. And now your host, Richard Thomas.
Hello, and welcome to It's a Miracle. Or to be more precise, it's a medical miracle. You're about to meet some people who have confounded the medical establishment by overcoming life-threatening conditions, incurable diseases, and in our first story, even death. Andrea Espinoza was 7 months pregnant when her friends and family gathered for a shower to celebrate the anticipated birth of a baby girl.
The day of my baby shower was really nice. I had a lot of family and friends there and a lot of people from work.
Andrea worked at Children's Hospital, and two of her friends were pediatric doctors, Tony Salome and Roshonda Clemens.
Andrea was just glowing. And we just had a ball, you know, just celebrating the life of the baby that we're expecting, you know.
We're all excited to have somebody to spoil, somebody to buy little girl clothes for. It was an exciting time.
And no one was more excited than Andrea's mom, Cindy.
I was very excited about having a granddaughter. I already had a grandson, and so I was very excited about having a little girl.
But fate took an unexpected turn 2 weeks later, when Andrea woke up in excruciating pain.
I could tell there was something wrong, but I didn't know exactly what it was.
Mom!
And I knew I was way too early along for me to be having the baby.
Mom!
Honey.
I have a pain.
What's going on?
She was in a lot of pain.
All right here.
Way down here.
Not like labor. More of a cramping and a sharp type of pain.
I couldn't do anything but cringe. It hurt so bad, and I started screaming.
Ow! Ow!
I'm gonna call the doctor for you.
Okay.
Hello? Hi, yeah, I need to speak with the doctor. And my daughter's having a lot of pain. She's 35 weeks along.
We said best thing to do is to just get in the car and drive to the hospital.
Almost immediately, Cindy found herself caught in rush hour traffic as Andrea's pains intensified.
I'm gonna start timing these, Andrea.
Okay,
tell me when you're done.
They were 45 seconds long, with only a few seconds in between. And I knew that was hard labor. And that's when I started to really get scared. So I drove in the emergency lane and whatever I had to do to get through the traffic.
It's okay, baby, I'm gonna get you here.
I just kept telling her, you're not gonna have the baby in the car. I'm gonna get you to the hospital on time. She was literally screaming in the car. The pain was so bad.
With just seconds to spare, Andrea was whisked into the delivery room.
For a couple hours.
Okay, doctor, we have a delivery here.
When they got me in the room, I asked them for an epidural, and the doctor told me it's way too late for that.
She said, you're gonna have the baby. I could feel my whole stomach tightening around the baby. It just felt like something wasn't right.
The nurse took the monitor and rubbed it on Edria's abdomen to hear the baby's heartbeat, and there was nothing. And that's when I knew that this was serious, that the baby wasn't okay.
Ready?
The doctors prepared Edria for a very quick delivery.
That's it. That's it.
I believe I had two contractions when I had her.
Hands out!
And she came out, she wasn't moving or breathing. And I saw them take her to the other side of the room and they started working on her.
There was no heart rate. The baby wasn't crying. There were no respirations that were audible at all.
All right, give me some epi.
Epinephrine was provided as well as medications to increase the blood pressure. There still was no signs of life in this child.
Edria and her mother watched helplessly as the doctors spent the next 30 minutes struggling to bring the stillborn baby back to life.
It just felt horrible because as a mother, you want to do anything that you can to help your children or to save them from anything happening. There's absolutely nothing that you can do.
Need some more blood.
You never want to stop resuscitating a baby. You never want to have to say, there's nothing else we can do, for the baby is not going to survive. That's like one of your biggest nightmares.
When I saw the neurologist shake his head, I knew that there was nothing that they could do.
I'm truly sorry, Edria.
Thank you for everything you did.
The grief on my daughter's face was so apparent. And I saw that there's nothing I can do that could make this better for her. Nothing.
My mom showed me her, and I wasn't ready to hold her yet. Because part of me just didn't want to accept what was happening. And then my mom held her for a while and rocked her.
All I could think of was I didn't want her to come into this world and leave without ever being held.
Are you ready to hold her, honey?
The first time I held my daughter in my arms, it just felt like everything that I wanted and everything that I was so happy about was taken away from me.
The emotional conclusion when It's a Miracle continues. After working frantically for more than 30 minutes trying to bring a stillborn baby back to life, the medical team was forced to give up and pronounce the baby girl dead. Before taking the infant away, her mother held her one last time in her arms.
Would you like to say a prayer before we start?
In the midst of her grief, Edria was asked if she would like her baby baptized.
That was the first time I talked to God in a long time, and I just asked him to please take care of her. I wasn't sure what I was going to name her yet, and I decided on Ayana because of its meaning, and it meant eternal bloom.
In the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, I baptize you, Ayana. Amen.
After the baptism, as Edria said her final goodbyes, something miraculous occurred.
All of a sudden, she just went. It was so loud, the nurse came in the room and heard it.
The staff rushed into the room. All of a sudden, there was like 10 people in the room.
When the doctors and the nurses came back to work on the baby, I was more scared than anything.
We got a heartbeat.
I just felt like I had already been through this once, and then I had to rewatch it again.
They did not want us to get excited about her coming to life. because she had gone so long without oxygen. She actually came back to life 65 minutes after she was born.
We're going to transfer her to ICU.
Against all odds, Ayana's breathing grew stronger. She was immediately transferred to the neonatal intensive care unit under the supervision of Andrea's friends, Doctors Salome and Clemens.
She was not moving much, not responding to anything. She had an EEG done, which measures brainwave activity.
I was one of the first ones to actually see the EEG readings and see how devastating they looked. The results were horrible.
It's bad.
Statistically, I wouldn't think that she would be able to eat on her own, to walk, to sit up, to meet any of the normal developmental milestones that normal babies do.
Nothing prepares you to have to tell a friend that their baby is not going to be totally normal or that their baby may not live. Nothing prepares you for that.
As you know, Ayana has suffered a severe brain insult.
But as painful as it was, the message had to be delivered.
And given the overall event, the results are not good.
At the meeting, it was explained to us that Ayana had severe brain damage. Their recommendation was that she be removed from life support.
You would have to sign this form.
And that Edria sign a no code blue, which means if the baby does die, that they don't try to resuscitate her.
Me working at Children's, I've seen moms refuse to let go of their children, and I didn't want to do that to her or to myself. And so I signed a do not resuscitate order.
That day, Ayana's life support was disconnected.
And they told me anywhere between an hour and a day she'll pass.
But the baby was not finished with her surprises.
I couldn't believe that she was breathing. She had a few gasping breaths there for a minute that were kind of scary, but after that she was breathing on her own.
The doctors would say, okay, well, she's breathing on her own, but she's not opening her eyes. And so a day later, she would open her eyes. And they would say, okay, well, she opened her eyes now, but she's not responding to voices. So a day later, you would call her name or you would talk to her, and you could see her intentionally move because you spoke to her. And they would say, well, she's okay, she's doing these two things, but she's not responding to touch. So a day later, you would touch her and she would grab your hand back.
And then she developed a suck, which meant that she could feed. That was kind of the point where we all were really excited.
That's when Dr. Salome said to Edria and I, this looks like this is Ayana's show, and we'll just wait to see what she does next.
And 15 days later, Ayana was well enough to leave the hospital.
Thank you, Tom.
Congratulations, Cindy.
The doctor just said she's a miracle baby. She's unbelievable, and we don't understand why or how, but we're not going to question it.
This has to be the works and the acts of God. There's no other explanation for it. I really believe there's no other explanation for it.
How about if you get the first piece, Isaiah?
Do you want cake?
Today, Ayana is a happy and healthy two-year-old, with none of the signs of developmental disorders normally associated with a traumatic birth.
I would say to anybody who is skeptical about it, you'd have to be there to know the magnitude of this miracle, truly. I held my grandbaby in my arms and she was dead, and she came back to life. There is no coincidence. It's a miracle, that's all there is to it.
The doctors who try to explain it, they don't have an explanation. And medically, there is none. There's no way to explain why she has absolutely nothing wrong with her. Ayana is a miracle.
If you didn't believe in medical miracles before, what do you say now? Well, we wanted to catch up with this miracle baby's progress. And so, Ayana, her mother, and grandmother join us now from Union City, California. Hi there.
Hi, Richard.
How are you?
Oh, I'm doing just fine, but more important, how's Ayana doing? Has she exceeded the doctor's expectations?
Well, she's exceeded them in every way possible.
House.
They didn't know if she would talk, and she talks very well. They didn't know if she would walk, if she would have any muscle tone at all. And she's done beautifully. She's doing all those things.
Mom, considering the doctor's grim predictions, what goes through your mind when you look at Ayana today?
She's just amazing to me. I really appreciate her a lot, and
they were wrong.
Yeah, they were wrong. It's true.
Yes, they were. I want to thank you for sharing this amazing story with us, and we wish you every happiness for the future.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye.
Goodbye. Goodbye, Ayana.
Bye.
We'll be right back.
Push me over that way.
Next, a husband watches helplessly as his wife succumbs to the effects of multiple sclerosis.
I try not to let my emotions show a whole lot. A lot of times I went in the room and cried by myself just because I didn't want her to see. But I know that there was plenty of times that she cried by herself too.
But soon they'll be crying tears of joy for the miracle they're about to discover.
Our next story concerns a debilitating and incurable disease, multiple sclerosis, or as it's more commonly known, MS. MS is a neurological disorder that slowly robs the nervous system of its protective covering, leaving the nerves exposed and resulting in symptoms ranging from blindness to paralysis and ultimately death. To overcome any potentially fatal illness is a miracle, but in this case, the miracle lives on and on. In 1967, Pat Fallon was a happy, active teenager when she began experiencing some strange physical symptoms.
I was probably 16 when I first noticed little things. It's like I couldn't sleep, and when I slept, I didn't want to get up. I was real tired. I got a lot of tingling, but I didn't relate it to a major problem.
It wasn't until after she graduated from high school and fell in love and married Ray Wagner that Pat's symptoms became more troubling. It started during the pregnancy of her first child.
Prior to having him, I had numbness and tingling in my legs, and the doctors thought it was the baby pushing on my pelvic nerves. But after I had him, my legs were still funny. And finally, one day I woke up and my foot was asleep.
Move your eyes to the left and right.
Pat was referred to a neurologist who performed a battery of tests. The results confirmed that Pat was suffering from multiple sclerosis.
We don't know that much about it. We don't know what causes it.
When I was first told that I have MS, it wasn't anything that really hit me hard because I didn't understand what MS was.
Pat was immediately placed on steroid therapy, and initially she responded well.
I just went about life thinking everything was fine. And then a couple years later, one steroid treatment didn't work. I had to go in two times that year. Things were like, my foot was asleep and staying asleep. Or am I stumbling? I kept stumbling. Now my whole leg is weak.
Oh.
She would get numbness in her hands, all over her whole body, as a matter of fact. She would lose the ability to stand or walk.
Can't get this to her.
It's painful. It's painful to watch your mate go from a healthy person full of life and having fun to all of a sudden not being able to and progressively getting worse, and there's nothing you can do about it. You don't know what to do about it.
The worst part of having MS is not knowing what's going to happen to you next week, next month, next year. It's the inability to do things that normal people do that you did once in your life. can't tell you what a heartbreak it is to know that you have the ability to do something, or you had it, and now you can't do it. It's a horrible, horrible disease. Horrible. And it doesn't give up.
Aww.
In 1975, I had my second child. And oh, I was so elated. Oh, I couldn't have loved her anymore. And one day I was walking down the hall with her, little thing in my arms. And there was like a heaviness. She's getting heavy. I just plain dropped that infant child.
No!
I cried. Oh, I cried so hard. Because this MS had me. It had control of my life. And I didn't like it.
Like it or not, Pat's disease continued to progress until years later she was completely wheelchair bound. Dr. Stuart Goodman was her primary caregiver.
Well, generally when we're treating patients with multiple sclerosis, we are treating symptoms, but no prevention, no cure. Pat was getting a little bit better, but never getting all better. So every time she would have an episode, we had a little addition to her deficits, to her problems. So she kept on going downhill little by little.
I had flare-ups of my MS, and then they'd give me more steroids, and it'd go away, and then come back, and I'd get steroids again, and it just seemed to be the way my life was going.
There are no other therapies for us to use. There is no cure, as you know, and there's no other treatment available at this time. So
finally, even the steroids stopped working, and Pat became bedridden, relying on multiple medications for multiple symptoms.
I absolutely lived on pills. I would probably say my daily oral intake was more pills than food. I always was taking a pill for one thing or another, just in hope, in desperation. I didn't feel any change whatsoever. And it came to the point where the doctor said, Pat, there's nothing more I can do for you. I want you to go home, be happy for the good times you've had, and kind of get your affairs in order.
Push me over that way.
It makes you feel very bad when you see your mate get down to the point where they can't do simple things. They can't sometimes feed themselves.
Let's try another little bite.
I tried not to let my emotions show a whole lot. A lot of times I went in the room and cried by myself just because I didn't want her to see. Yeah. But I know that there was plenty of times that she cried by herself too. All right, honey, I'm gonna finish getting ready and I'll say goodbye before I leave.
You can't feel anybody's emotion. You can't feel anybody's love for you because you can't feel their arms around you. You can't feel them touch your face when they want to kiss you. My MS was not letting up where it did before. It wasn't letting up. I felt like this is the end. This is the end. I know it's coming. I can't live like this.
While Pat remained in bed waiting to die, other forces were being set into motion. The miraculous conclusion when we return to It's a Miracle.
Still to come. A strange and amazing experiment.
All I have to do is put this bee on your body and it'll sting just like that.
I said, this is a ludicrous idea, but if you really think you want to do this, I'm not going to tell you no.
Discover the power of a bee's sting when It's a Miracle continues. It's a Miracle will return.
Pat Wagner had spent 22 years fighting the crippling effects of multiple sclerosis and trying every possible treatment and drug to stop her body's slow deterioration. But nothing in modern medicine seemed to help. And then, in 1992, she received a call that would change her life forever.
Hello? Hi, Mom.
Pat's mother had heard of a beekeeper who was using bee venom to treat his wife's arthritis.
She wants to know if you'd like to get a bee sting and see what it might do for your health. I'm listening. I said, a bee sting? Mom, what is a little bee sting going to do?
I don't care. They can't hurt me.
Out of sheer desperation, Pat decided to give it a try.
I said, this is a ludicrous idea, but if you really think you want to do this, I'm not going to tell you no.
And so, one morning, the beekeeper, Bob Corey, arrived at their door.
Ray Wagner?
Yes.
That's Bob Corey.
I agreed that I would treat this girl. I collected some bees from my beehives, and we got them in a jar, and I came down here and saw Pat.
Hey, honey, this is Bob Corey.
The room was boiling hot. She had an electric heater going. It was over 90 degrees. And she said that she was cold all the time.
I brought some bees with me.
When I looked at her legs, had kind of a purplish hue to them, and where it looked like the very poor circulation.
There's no guarantee this is going to help you, but it's worth a try.
As Bob removed a bee he'd brought with him, he explained that one out of 174,000 people were allergic to honeybee venom, so they would have to do a test sting.
Sting just like that. I like to sting up and around the knee area. A lot of times when people have trouble with their legs, that seems to help them a lot.
Stung my knee, and then he pulls the bee away, and there's a little stinger stuck in me.
Now, if you're going to have an allergic reaction, it'll show up very rapidly. I'd like to wait for about 20 minutes, and then we'll give you a few more stings. And then we sort of chatted for a while, and next thing we know, she says, something's happening with my leg.
Like from the top of my thigh all the way down to the ankle, it feels warm.
She felt warmth in her leg, and she thought that by itself was pretty neat, you know?
When I felt that warmth 20 minutes after that sting, it's like I could hardly believe it.
And I had a few more bees with me, and she said, I want the rest of them.
Okay, here we go.
That day, Bob used all the bees he'd brought.
Sting is in, and we're going to put it right down here on your arm.
And miraculously, with each sting, Pat regained some feeling.
By the next day, she had the body warmth, which was a big thing to her, because of being cold all the time.
Bob continued his visits for the next 2 weeks, and Pat's health improved with each passing day.
See, I hope this one works. Where do we want this one? Right over here, huh? Okay. Oh, that's a good one. Yeah. Ooh, gotcha, huh? Making you react a little bit there.
It doesn't hurt, it's just making
it made your leg jump. That's
it was
really
amazing. In that same 2 week time, my husband saw such an increase in my overall energy.
And it wasn't long after that she was able to get out of bed on her own and even walk. So I was really becoming amazed, totally amazed that her functions were coming back.
Pat, please come in.
Oh, God, you're walking.
Wow. Her doctor, Stuart Goodman, was equally amazed.
Tremendous. Please, come in.
Pat comes into the office in the wheelchair and suddenly stands and is able to walk, which is a great surprise to me, certainly a pleasing surprise.
I got my first sting in my left knee, and Doc, 20 minutes...
That was the first time I ever heard of using bee stings, and I was quite interested. Yes.
Let me see you pick up your left leg, please.
Clinically, she showed improvement based on the physical examination. And then we did get a repeat MRI scan of the brain. And as we compared it to the prior study, there certainly were no new areas of nervous system involvement. And the areas that had been there in the past had lessened.
And he has realized that my improvement completely corresponds to my use of bee venom therapy.
Sam, when you think you got enough, that's Blobbery Punny right there.
Soon, Pat's husband, Ray, was learning how to keep bees and sting Pat himself.
And they're all ready to sting, too. They get a little bit angry when you mess around with them like this.
Bob was very, very instrumental in showing me how to get the bees out of the top of the hive without getting myself stung to death.
I get a little better control when I hold them by the wings.
As I progressively saw Pat get better, I was elated that she could do things that she hadn't done for months.
Are you going to sting my hands to try to get them to warm up?
Yes.
Word of Pat's amazing improvement spread, And today she runs a clinic from her home where she shares the benefits of bee venom therapy with thousands of people annually.
Feel that?
Yes.
That's right,
man. I love it when you get feeling that. To date, I've probably stung 18,000 people. Bee venom therapy is not a cure, at least for MS. I can't even say, you know, it's going to get you out of a wheelchair. But bee venom therapy, it's going to do something to you in a beneficial way. You'll feel better.
And if you don't believe Pat, just ask the people she's been helping.
The area that's painful is reducing in size. Every time I come get it stung, it feels better.
She keeps me on my feet and keeps me living a life. I have a life now where I didn't have one before.
I couldn't do this 5 years ago without being in pain. And now?
The right eye wanders to the right quite often, and with the sting, they come back to alignment.
Although scientists are still unsure about exactly how it works, they have identified at least 18 active ingredients in fresh bee venom.
Something in the bee venom is helping patients cure themselves through the bee sting therapy much quicker than on their own or without any type of therapy.
Oh, yeah, that is. Oh!
Excuse me. Bees are a miracle. Everything they do is a miracle. Oh, right now, to me, life is a miracle. It's a whole new thing. It's a whole new life, and it's a miracle.
That is so good.
If you or someone you know could benefit from bee therapy, you may want to grab a pencil and paper because we're about to get some specific information from Pat on how you can get involved. She and her husband, Ray, join us now from their home in Waldorf, Maryland. Hi there. How are you both doing today?
Hey, Richard. We're doing fine.
Richard, it's a wonderful day.
I'm glad to hear that. You both look well. How are you feeling, Pat?
Feeling real good. Real good. Thank you.
If she's feeling good, I'm feeling real good.
Well, it's wonderful to see the smiles on your faces, especially after watching the long and difficult road you've traveled. I think probably the question that's on most viewers' minds right now is, how do I find out more about bee therapy?
Well, they can contact me. They can get my book that will explain to them how to do this bee stings and where to do the bee stings and what vitamins that are beneficial. They can contact the American Apitherapy Society. There's a lot of places out there. You go to the internet, you'll find a lot out there. It's out there. This is something to be reckoned with.
And how can the viewers reach you?
I have a website, and please visit. It's www.olg.com/bee lady. That's me.
Well, it's a pleasure to meet you both, and thank you for sharing your miracle with us.
Thanks for having us, Richard. We surely did. We enjoyed it thoroughly.
And be well.
Yes, definitely be well.
If you're going to try bee therapy, be sure you get all the information. Once again, you can reach Pat Wagner at olg.com/bee lady. We'll be right back.
Coming up, nothing ever came between brothers Kelly and Casey Powers. They were inseparable.
When people met him, they never forgot him because they did look alike.
But their bond would be tested when Casey is involved in a severe auto accident that leaves him comatose and on life support. A medical miracle of brotherly love when this special edition of It's a Miracle continues.
Our next medical miracle is unique in that it was captured on videotape. It's the day-by-day chronicle of one family's ordeal in facing what could have been a terrible tragedy. But more important, it's a testament to the power of faith, hope, and brotherly love. The Powers twins, Kelly and Casey, were identical and inseparable.
When people met him, they never forgot him because they did look alike.
But their bond went deeper than their looks. And when Casey was involved in a head-on car collision that left him with severe brain injuries, in a coma, and on life support, his brother Kelly quit his job to be near him. The twins' mother, Lynn Powers, decided to videotape what she hoped would be a miraculous recovery.
I was videotaping him because I saw changes within 1 week that were just unbelievable. And when he starts his recovery, he can look back and see how far he's come, then it'll give him encouragement to continue.
This is his fourth week.
Yeah.
And he's a lot better.
People were against using the videotape because Casey looked so bad. He was deformed with the paralysis, and his eyes were vacant.
It wasn't at all like you see in the movies where you come out of the coma. It was very gradual.
But however long it would take, Kelly was determined to stay by his brother's side, giving him hope and encouragement.
Very good.
That's great.
6 weeks after the accident.
His therapist, Debbie Rickard, was not as hopeful.
When Casey first came here, he told me that his goals were to play the drums again and to walk really well. Looking at him, I really had no idea how he was going to do that again.
That's all well. Better than
I wish I could put sweat on this.
Well, you can touch it down. And touch
it really hurts, though.
At first there, just about everything hurt. I knew if I wanted to walk again or do anything again, I had to do it, so I just did it.
Gonna fall, though.
No, we got you.
Ow.
Right in the middle there?
Having a limb on your body that used to move and just all of a sudden it won't work at all, it's one of the most frustrating things that there is.
But no matter how frustrating things got, Kelly was there to help his brother through the difficult times.
No pain, no gain. You kind of have mixed emotions because you're very happy to see him accomplishing these things, like walking with the bars and riding the bike. But, you know, it's very hard because you can see that he's in so much pain.
I think Kelly was very special, and he really seemed to have a special feel for how to help. A lot of families kind of back away because they're not sure, and I think you can see from the tapes how much he cared about his brother and how he helped his brother move around.
I love this girl.
Kelly and I were talking one day, and I said, Kelly, you know, I have this song running through my head about Casey.
My mother had wrote the words, and I wrote the music to this song, and we put it together.
It happened in an instant, and all our lives have changed. Who can explain it when lives are rearranged? How could this happen, God? Please take away the pain, show us the reason.
The first time I heard this song, I just couldn't believe it. It made me cry. I really think that song inspired me to have a good recovery.
Silent impact, not a sound,
but he will rise.
I was doing speech therapy, physical therapy, occupational therapy, and pool therapy. For the first 10 months, I went 5 days a week, 8 hours a day. I didn't know how much better I was going to get, but I knew that it was going to get better than it was.
A lot of the times, Casey and I sit down together, even from day one, to set goals as to how far he wants to get. He would set his goals kind of high sometimes.
Casey, come up here and join us.
When Casey came to us and told us that he wanted to do the 5-mile race in his wheelchair, we were kind of leery because that was a really long ways, and he hadn't gone that far in practice or in therapy.
Hey, Casey!
Come on!
We stopped his wheelchair, put on his braces that he needed on his leg, and set his walker in front of him, and he walked the last couple hundred yards.
Hi, Casey!
What up, getting ready to use the cane here.
I was the slowest one in the race, so everybody was there at the finish line.
It was a moment of incredible personal victory for Casey, but there was still one more important challenge ahead.
I had asked him to be best man at my wedding. So he said, well, by your wedding, I'm going to set a goal to where I can walk down the aisle without a walker or a cane or anything.
I said, Casey, you don't want to set yourself unrealistic goals. You have to be realistic. And I think that made him even more determined.
When he walked out, it was so joyous. It was probably one of the happiest occasions for our family.
I was just so happy to see him walking, so I put the camera down and just sat there and enjoyed it.
As she watched Casey achieve his goal to be Kelly's best man, Lynn couldn't help but think how Kelly had been the best man in Casey's life as well. Sticking by his brother through each step of his miraculous recovery, and giving him the hope and courage to make his dreams come true. It's a miracle born of a very special bond.
I love this guy.
If you'd like to share your miraculous story, write to us or check out our website at itsamiracle.com.
Well, that's our show for now. Thank you for joining us. And a special thanks to all the people who shared their remarkable stories tonight on It's a Miracle. It's our hope that whenever you need one, you'll find a miracle in your life too. Until next time, I'm Richard Thomas. Goodbye. Thank you.